Alright everybody, welcome to week number 2 here of my video series. We're going to be battling with what I like to call Azorius Control, blue-white planeswalkers, blue-white, insert my favorite mythic rares from Standards Past, whatever you like to call the deck. I personally call it Azorius Control, but I apparently also call it Modern Blue-White Control. So, today we're going to be battling with basically a tap-out style control deck outside of essentially these Cryptic Commands. Main focus of this deck, again, we're looking to beat up some Eldrazi, we're looking to beat up some Death Shadows. If you read my article earlier in the week, this is the list that I played, or at least this list that was similar to what I played at Grand Prix San Antonio when I teamed with Sam Black and Justin Cohen. Our decks were an Amulet Titan deck, a Jund Death Shadow deck, and I was piloting our Bullet Control deck. And we basically determined that this deck had a very good Death Shadow matchup. Most of that comes in the form of Path to Exile being a one-mana removal spell, interacting with, you know, their Gurmag Anglers, their Death Shadows, Tarmogoyf potentially if they're on a green version. For one mana is very effective, and then Snapcaster Mage pairs very well with that, being able to just, we don't care the size of your creature, we don't care if you're a 12-12, we don't care if you're a 7-7, we don't care if you're a 3-3, get off the board. Snapcaster pairs really well with that, make it happen many times over. And then Supreme Verdict being the other big one now that Grixis has picked up. Stubborn Denial is one of the big highlights of that deck, and being able to have a spell that is uncounterable gets through, I mean, basically any of their counter magic, not just Stubborn Denial. Also does some work in other matchups, say Merfolk. And I mean, just all around, Wrath of Gods are, you know, very powerful for control decks, and it's going to pair very well with bridging into our Planeswalkers, which are going to want to protect Gideon Jura, Elspeth's Champion, and Jace Architect of Thought to help us close out the game here, as this is one of the lightest win condition decks you'll ever find in Modern. One of the sort of highlights of the Modern format is the cards are so powerful you really have to get your opponent dead quickly. This deck doesn't really do that. You have Celestial Colonnades, Snapcaster Mages, and Gideons that really do damage, and then Elspeth that can pile on some damage with the help of some friends. But outside of that, you're really not killing your opponent. You're sort of, similarly to what I like about Grixis Control, you're grinding your opponent into oblivion, and then applying something that they're not going to be able to deal with is sort of the top end here of Bullet Control. And again, that comes in the power of your Planeswalker, Sphinx's Revelation, or just 2-for-1-ing them, or 3-for-1-ing them potentially with Cryptics and Supreme Verdicts. Rounding out the rest of the deck here, Serum Visions, kind of the staple of blue decks. We got a little suite of counter magic here. I've got one Spell Snare, one Negate, and two Mana Leaks. I'm not certain on what the correct numbers here are. I had Remand previously. Didn't like Remand, caught it before the Grand Prix. Considered trying out Censor. I see that's something that people are trying out of late. Now that we're looking at when Hour of Devastation will be legal, Nibble Obstructionist is a card you could play. It would also be similar to Vendilion Cloak that you see over here on the sideboard, Flash Flyer that can help us kill our opponents, pressure Planeswalkers, but could also function as like a Shadow of Doubt, preventing a fetch land or stopping some other triggered ability. It's a card that I would definitely consider, however, the 3 mana on its activated cycling power is a little bit much. The lands aren't anything special. We got some fetch lands, a ton of basics here to get around Blood Moon, also just make our mana base much less painful, and then Tectonic Edge, which pairs well, really well with Spreading Seas. Because the games are going to go very long, you have to have answers to your opponent's permanents, and this will buy you time so they just don't play their permanents for a while. I wouldn't say too many games are won by mana screwing your opponent, but it's, I mean, we're talking 10-12%. There are definitely games where you just have 2 Spreading Seas and a Tectonic Edge, and they draw 4 lands in the first 6 turns, and they just don't really cast spells, and eventually you resolve some sweet Planeswalker or Cryptic Command their first spell afterwards, and you're off to the races. Getting to the sideboard here, I think the spell cores are pretty industry standard at this point. They pair pretty well with these extra 2 counter spells and this other flash creature. You bring these in basically in any matchup you're willing to board out Supreme Verdict, but you will also bring them in sometimes when you're leaving Supreme Verdict in. And those matchups tend to be the ones that are more tricky, something like Affinity, where you really have to sort of leverage your spots where you are going to need to know what you're going to need a Supreme Verdict. Example, they have an Etch Champion out. You probably don't want a Spell Queller, a spell, unless it's going to kill you, because you're going to need a Supreme Verdict at some point during that game's tail to get that Etch Champion off the battlefield. unless you're going to try to, you know, Gideon and plus and just try to survive it. It's a complicated and dicey spot that's going to take a little bit of learning, a bit of a learning curve to figure out how to play with those two cards in your deck simultaneously. But it is something this deck does from time to time. Similarly, Rest in Peace is another card when you're playing a graveyard-centric deck. We're not exceptionally graveyard-centric. We don't have devil spells like Logic Knot or Tasigur or anything of that nature, but we do have some Snapcaster Mages over here, and these Rest in Pieces are in pure conflict with them. What I tend to do is when I'm hyper-dependent on my Rest in Peace, I'll board in all the Rest in Pieces and take out the Snapcaster Mages. But against a deck like Grixis Shadow, where Rest in Peace is very good, but isn't the nail in the coffin, like it doesn't just kill them, I'll leave in some number of the Snapcaster Mages, usually one or two, sometimes even all three, but I'll also bring in two or three of the Rest in Pieces. Running out the sideboard, we got an extra copy of Blessed Alliance, good against Eldrazi, Burn, Death Shadow, things of that nature, another just useful sideboard card, and then Celestial Purge, which, again, great against Death Shadow, good against things like, Storm to a minor extent now, they're not on Pyromancer's Ascension, used to be much better there. Solid against Burn, if we happen to play against, like, the Scred Red, I guess this card's pretty great. All in all, I think this is probably a card we can get down to one of. There's also some new technology possibly coming out in our devastation. If the Death and Taxes deck continue to pick up, maybe we'll want a copy of Gideon's Defeat to have another one mana removal spell. Maybe we'll go back to playing a copy of Condemn. Maybe we'll play a second copy of Dismember. We'll have to balance all these things out, but in all, that's the intro for this week. Let's get into some matches and battle with our blue-white control deck here in Modern. Alright, everybody, welcome to round one here with blue-white control. We are definitely going to be on the play with this. And so this is one of the oddities here in this deck. When you play four Tectonic Edges, sometimes you open up on hands where you can't actually cast a spell in your hand other than a Snapcaster Mage as a 2-1. I'm going to chuck this back. Three passes, whatever. This hand, however, is, pretty medium, but perfectly fine. Hopefully this is a matchup where Gideon and Dismember shine. Dismember's actually a nice little combo here with all these Celestial Colonnades, as it's always one mana and four life to -5/-5 a creature in this deck. So hopefully we can go Colonnade, and combo off the Dismember on two, a Path to Exile. I'd rather have it than not. Basic plan of this deck, just kill most of their creatures, resolve some giant awesome spell, win the game with that giant awesome spell. With the Gideon, an Elspeth, a Jace, a Sphinx's Revelation, something of that nature to take over. Doesn't really matter what it is, as long as you're doing something after controlling the game for the first 4 to 5 turns. Alright, so it looks like my opponent's Grixis or Esper Death Shadow here. I guess it could also be Sultai, but not my first guess. So I don't think green adds much to the deck that white or red doesn't. Straight up down to 14. Thoughtseize. Well, that's a little rude. That is rude, dude. Alright, thankfully I have two removal spells here, so our opponent can't just, like, jam a threat into us like a Death Shadow here without, I guess three Street Rays, but another nice facet of this matchup is Celestial Colonnade. They get themselves low enough that Celestial Colonnade over the course of a turn or two can pretty quickly turn the corner. Having a Serra Angel as a land is pretty fantastic. Alright, so they do lead on a 1-1 Dust Shadow. As I said before, it's two Celestial Colonnades, a nice little combo. Go ahead and kill that right now. Ooh, Cryptic Command. Hopefully find an island. Gonna lean on this tech edge because I'd rather have a tech edge on the battlefield in case we do draw an island. Toss these again, so I assume our opponent will just take our Cryptic here. And hopefully don't have a Tasker to follow up. Alright, so take our Cryptic. Another fetch land. So, looks like they are in fact Grixis Shadow. Bloodstained Mire is usually a giveaway, as otherwise you'd be playing Flooded Strand for Esper. Steam Vent's tapped. I assume it's the Gurmag Angler Tasker then. Alright, Tassigoyf. Yeah, Supreme Verdict's not too shabby. Use that to clean the board here. Just want to try to get to a spot where this Gideon can resolve. My opponent seems to be pretty knowledgeable of the damage the Celestial Colony can do, fetching that Steam Vents tap. They also didn't need the extra cards. But keeping themselves at 9 is much safer than getting themselves down to 8. So we can Snapcast your Thought Seize tier down to 7. Can't strip my opponent of this red source, but not high on my list of priorities. A little odd that you would Snapcast or a Thought Seizer before Serum Vigilancing first. Like, if you'd had a Call of Guns command, I think it's better if they set up for that before just Thought Seizing me straight up. Alright, well, Elspeth's not a great draw when you're stuck on 4 mana. We could blow up our opponent's Steam Vents. That puts us even further away from this Colonnade. Our opponent did top a card. Makes me a little more likely to want to do it, but I think drawing a 6 mana spell is just better to ship the turn back here. Hope to draw, like, Spreading Seas into Spreading Seas into a land or something crazy of that nature. Ooh, Sleight of Hand also. Lots of cantrips. So, Scalding Tarn. So they've got all the red mana in the world. We don't really need to worry about strip mining them here with our Tectonic Edge. Another Supreme Verdict. I think I'm going to hold off on that for another turn. It could get susceptible where my opponent draws like another Thoughtseize, but I'd rather be able to get two creatures. It's not like without Claim to Fame yet that our opponent can actually get Hasted Death Shadows or Hasty Tassiger or Gurmag Anglers out on us. Alright, so someone just in a holding pattern here. Tension Sphere is also not fantastic against the Snapcaster Mage. I could do it to make our opponent actually like run out another threat. Not like super opposed to that. It also gets a card out of our hand for Inquisition. Alright. Yeah, it's not like this D-Sphere is going to explode, so. I would in fact like to exile my opponent's 2-1. Still not cracking their fetch land. That means our opponent doesn't have something like a Street Wraith in their hand they could look to cast. Alright, another Sleight of Hand. Black. Hopefully this is an Inquisition that we managed to get around. Nope, it's a Death Shadow. Alright, another fetch land for our opponent. Hopefully find a land this turn. Mana Leak. Well, that's sort of outlived its usefulness at this point. Let's go ahead and wrath away this dreadful 6-6 that can grow to a 12-12. Yeah, this is one of the reasons why I'm not a big fan of Mana Leak. Decks that tend to play longer games, like, eventually you're going to turn on your opponent's, like, removal in situations where you can play creatures, and in cases like this, like, eventually the Mana Leak just turns off because they should get enough lands out there. Like, all of our opponent's spells are so cheap. Here, Spreading Seas in the red source because it forces them to crack a fetch land. Get red source back. Unfortunately, brick on a land again. Thankfully, if we draw an untapped land now, our opponent can't just, like, Stubborn Denial us. What was this? Zombie Fish? Ooh, we might be able to use this Mana Leak effectively here, then. This is Zombie Fish, and I can get them to crack multiple fetch lands. That wouldn't be the worst thing ever. I would also be perfectly happy trading this Mana Leak for a Stubborn Denial, which is likely one of the cards in our opponent's hand. Between that, Fatal Push, Terminate. Alright, looks like they're cracking a Scalding Tarn.
So blue, blue. There you go. You need a black mana for a zombie fish. Opponent's like trying to figure out the best way to leave up certain spells here, and it's on us to discern what those are. It feels like one of them's Dismember. And our opponent's also trying to figure out like the best cards to leave in their graveyard if they draw Kolaghan's Command. Alright, they eventually just determine they're just gonna run out their silly zombie fish. And I don't think it's worth it to mana like this, because they have all their mana open. So we could run out Jace here, minus Jace if our opponent doesn't just straight up Stubborn Denial, which I'd expect them to do. My hope is that they don't have Stubborn Denial and a Snapcaster Mage. That'd be rather rough. Yeah, I think I'm gonna run out Jace, expected to get Stubborn Denialed. So what I really want to do is just resolve this path, because our opponent doesn't have any more basics. Alright, as expected, Jace hits the bin. I think our opponent should have fetched a Blood Crypt there. I think so. I mean, maybe it leaves them open to another Spreading Seas too effectively, but... Ooh, a second path makes this a lot better. Alright, so I'm going to pass into my opponent's upkeep, and we'll fight there. Again, I think it's also better to do this on their upkeep because they don't have another basic, and I do want to shuffle in whatever they've scryed away, but I guess they've already shuffled since then, so it shouldn't matter too much. Alright, letting that resolve gives us a tell that our opponent doesn't have another Stubborn Denial or Snapcaster, so I'd expect their hand to be two removal spells and a land at this point. Just going to try to slowly build up here to Elspeth. Ooh, Hallowed Fountain. That will count. Counts towards the team. Alright, nothing again from our opponent. Again, I would just be assuming a lot of removal, maybe more fetch lands. Cryptic Commando. Alright. It will accept Cryptic Commando as a decent draw. Still in a weird spot here. If our opponent like fetches a Bloodstained Mire and gets a tap Blood Crypt, whether or not we're supposed to... Alright, do I want to Cryptic this? Whether or not we're supposed to Tectonic Edge in our end step. I think I'm going to counter this and draw a card. I think the Path to Exile is just worth protecting. Another Colonnade, not the worst thing ever, also not the best thing ever. Blue, blue. Alright, so they're gonna Snapcaster back Inquisition. Since I'm pretty happy with this Mana Leak going away, I'm just gonna path this Snapcaster actually. Again, this is just basically a source of Plowshares at this point where they don't gain life. My Mana Leak I already assume is a dead card, so I'm A-okay with it going away. So, looking at our opponent's Exile pile, there's no Stubborn Denial over here, and they know about the Elspeth now. So if we draw an untapped land, I think we're supposed to just jam the Elspeth. Fortunately, we do not, but we do find a Serum Vision, so we'll go ahead and use that. That we can find. Found an island. We definitely don't want this Flooded Strand. I'll definitely take this other Serum Vigilance, however. And we'll get this a millionth Colonnade on the battlefield. Let's not have six, because in case our opponent cracks this Bloodstained Mires I've been talking about, we should Tectonic Edge it. Especially now we have the extra land. So we have a land now that we can play Elspeth through Stubborn Denial. Opponent found a Serum Visions. Not great. Rooting for bottom. There's one bottom. That's a positive. Come on. So let's see, what do they have left? So they left the second card on top, and they're just passing turn now. Alright, well, we do have a land to pay first over now, so hopefully it's not Dubskis. Land. Alright, the Sun's champion. I choose her. Ooh, alright, that's good. That is nice. I'll definitely take concessions to 6 mana planeswalkers. God, this feels like standard all over again. Get to combine your favorite Jace or your favorite Elspeth, and maybe toss in a little Gideon action. I mean, this deck is just a delight. Alright, so in this matchup, we definitely want both the Celestial Purges. I mean, this is one of the reasons to play, you know, white in general in modern. I mean, in most formats in general, is white tends to just have these very high impact sideboard cards. Especially once you get to modern, we have Rest in Peace, we've got Celestial Purge. We could theoretically bring in the Quellers in this matchup. Not my style, but you can certainly do that. As for sideboarding out, I was saying earlier, I don't really like Mana Leak. Not a big fan. Detention Seer is fine. Dismember's fine. Negate is fairly ineffective. And I like shaving the Snapcasters when bringing the Rest in Peace package. It's a little odd to have... Oops. Sorry, Sphinx of Revelation. Come on back. It's a little awkward to have Snapcaster Mages in the same deck with Rest in Peace. But I found when I was testing this deck for Grand Prix San Antonio, the Team Modern tournament, that the decks that you were willing to bring in Rest in Peace against were so ineffective when they didn't have a graveyard that you just really didn't care that you weren't getting value out of your Snapcaster Mages. So we're going to board out those for Rest in Pieces, bring in the two Purges. I do leave one Snapcaster Mage in as a hedge where it's just kind of like this very good card. I don't really like Quellers or Vendilion Clicks. Stony Sound's obviously not very good. Our opponent doesn't really have any artifacts. The negates are fine if we see our opponent having Planeswalkers. I think it's fine. You can like leave in one of these, perhaps. The Spellsnare I'm literally leaving in for my opponent's set of Snapcaster Mages. But that could be incorrect because we're bringing in all of these awesome Rest in Peace actions. So let's actually give that a try. Let's cut the Snare and leave in one of these negates. Not going to leave in Dispel. I don't want to try to counter my opponent's like Kolaghan's Commands and Starboard Annals with this. I'd rather have a card like Negate that could also hit Planeswalkers and or discard spells. The one copy of Blessed Alliance is as mediocre as you can imagine. The Rats are fantastic. This is a way to get out from under all of the Starboard Annal plus Delve Creature action that I was talking about during the deck intro. And other than that, I love leaving in all of the top end here, as you just want these explosive cards you can draw in the late game and take over the match. Alright, so getting into game two here. We're going to be on the draw. And this hand's fantastic. We'll be able to fetch probably Island, play Plains, play Rest in Peace, fetch a tap Flooded Strand, or excuse me, Hallowed Fountain with my Flooded Strand. This hand basically just says everything that I want. Enough lands to do some sweet stuff, a cantrip to try to find us more action, a Rest in Peace, and our opponent's going to six cards. Can't really ask for much more. Maybe we can roof them to not have a Thought Scour, that'd be great. Alright, let's see if we're going to get Thoughtseize here in turn one. Alright, Watery Grave. I usually like from Shadows when you're on the play. Okay, so Inquisition. I would expect them to take my Rest in Peace here. Yep, they do. Alright, well, we've got two more copies where that one came from. Alright, another Plains. That pretty much sets us up for all of life here on this. Just getting Island, the other one getting Island. Alright, found a Negate, which I think in this scenario I don't particularly want. I just kind of want to find some removal. So we'll bottom both of those. Have all five of our land drops now for Gideon. That's always sweet. Kind of just looking to find, like, another copy of Rest in Peace, some removal, and some card draw to get through to the end portion of the game from the mid game. So we pretty much have this, you know, sort of endgame threat here with Gideon Jura. We just need to make sure we make it to Gideon in one piece. Collective Brutality. All right, well, that's unfortunate for our Serum Visions we drew. Ooh, second Gideon. All right, well, I'm just gonna get this flooded straight out here. Even though we put two cards on the bottom, like, not unhappy, just getting the Hallowed Fountain here. Not likely we ever need triple white, but pretty happy just fetching and not having to take additional points of damage. Alright, what is this? Liliana, the Last Hope. Alright, well, I definitely wish I'd left the negate on top now, don't I? That is fine. I could beat zombies. Alright, let's go find us a Celestial Purge. Colonnade down, that can harass Liliana later. So I cycled Street Wraith. I would almost expect our opponent here to minus Lily to pick up Street Wraith again to draw another card, because their hand's just, like, not been doing much. Going to 8. The Snapcaster Brutality us. I will show you a full house. Gideon's, or lands full of Gideon's. Sorry about that whammy. Alright, so my opponent knows now they're in for some trouble, and this Liliana basically needs to go ultimate, but they're about to play a Delph threat here based on how they're tapping. So the answer's on me. If I can find a Supreme Verdict here, I would say I'm a huge favorite. Alright, it's just a Tasker, thank goodness. 6 power, however, at 18 life. Still tricky. Another Colonnade. Well, Gideon in combination with the Colonnade attack does kill our opponent, so run out the Colonnade, it doesn't really matter, our opponent knows what we drew. Our basic plan here is just run out Tectonic Edge next turn, plus Gideon targeting them, and then the turn after, play a land, use Gideon to zero, and then attack Colonnade and Gideon at our opponent's face. Interesting that our opponent left Brutality as the last card rather than leaving the Street Wraith that they could buy back, because they are saying they are going to draw a spell now. The thing is, it has to be a good spell. Snappy doesn't change our plan here any. I'm just gonna run out Gideon. Run out the Gidfather. Could just blow up this Tasiger. Let's see here. Alright, so we're in a close spot here on whether or not we want to just kill this Tasiger off, or whether or not we want to plus the Gideon. My inclination tells me to plus the Gideon. The reason for plusing the Gideon instead of minusing the Gideon is the Snapcaster then is forced to attack into the Gideon Jura. And by being forced to attack into the Gideon Jura, it's not there to block the Gideon when it zeroes on the comeback. And the Celestial Colony plus the Gideon can deal the last 10 points to our opponent. It is a little bit more risky if our opponent has a Colagon's Command, but I think it's the best line of play. So I'm going to go ahead and plus Gideon, targeting our opponent. Force the Banana King and the Snapcaster to get down with the White Planeswalker. I think this line's also okay because we have the second Gideon. So our opponent did draw something fantastic. Alright, so here they're looking at Street Wraith, Collective Brutality, and Death Shadow. Our creature gets -2/-2. So I don't care if they drain me for 2, because it's loss of life, not dealing damage, that won't kill Gideon. And them going to 10 life isn't scary to me. And I definitely don't want to give them another card of the Street Wraith, and I definitely don't want to give them a blocker. So I'm just going to give them back the Collective Brutality. My opponent wants to get another card back. I'm going to make them minus their Liliana. Just try to use this Gideon as like a double fog. So they Thoughtscar themselves, milled over another Street Wraith, and another Collective Brutality. They have a lot of Collective Brutalities in their deck, which is, I think is a little surprising to me. Sure, I have Supreme Verdicts and Cryptics, which are expensive sorceries and instances. Alright, Thoughtseize. I expect that to take my second copy of Gideon. I think that's going to explain to my opponent that they need to Liliana here and get back that Death Shadow. Alright, so these two must attack Gideon. I'll drop Gideon's loyalty down to 2 here. So in our turn, our plan is to play a Plains, animate the Colonnade, Colonnade attack our opponent down to 2, because this Lily should go to 4, excuse me. Getting back a Death Shadow, and we'll plus Gideon targeting our opponent again. So I think they're going to need to find something to deal with the Colonnade to get out of this. So they milled over a Thought Season of Serum, so they should be just getting back this Death Shadow as expected. So we know 2 of the 3 cards in their hand. So now one of these is a Collector Brutality and one's an Unknown. And, okay, so we drew a Supreme Verdict and that'll end the game, but we were definitely in an interesting spot if that wasn't how the game was going to end. But I will definitely take the clean answer. I guess we should play Plains first. In case there's some random reason I need to play a Snapcaster, but I can't imagine. And zero Gideon into the human soldier that he's meant to be. And we won the match. All right, sweet. So, as I was saying earlier, blue-white, definitely a great deck if you want to beat up on some shadow players. Not sure how it does against Eldrazi Tron just yet, but we will hopefully fight one of those here in the coming 4 rounds. So stay tuned, and thanks for watching. All right, everybody, welcome back for round number 2 here with blue-white control in Modern. We've lost the die roll, but hopefully up against some more shadows players that are asking for it. This hand's great, just needs another Plains here to cast some Supreme Verdicts. We got 3 blue for our Cryptic. Mana Leak is early interaction. Certainly a Snap Keep. A hand that can get into some dicey spots, but... Oh god, Snow-Covered Mountain, my worst nightmare. Oh dear lord, not like this. Alright, well we're gonna hold on to this Serum Visions till turn 3. We need to figure out what our hand's developing into. Plus we don't want to get ourselves caught with playing our white sources, our tap line later on. Alright, opponent gets a Mindstone out, so we're going to try and Mana Leak their 4 play. Relic, we're not too concerned with. Alright. 6 mana Planeswalker, that is a way to win the game. So we'll move Elspeth over here to the left. We'll get her ready for some action later. Oh, Scredbread. Alright, hopefully this is a Chandra. Alright, Koth of the Hammer. Definitely not happening. Get out of here, Koth. Not beating a Koth with this hand without countering it, so we'll counter it then. It's probably going to Relic us. Hopefully their follow-up's not another Planeswalker and it's just a Storm Breath Dragon, Thundermaw Hellkite, you know, your sort of flavor of the week super awesome giant monster. I'm going to play Serum Visions here before playing our land in case we find a Celestial Colonnade or Hellfount we want to play tapped. I'm trying to cast my spell. Alright, sorry about that. Moda decided it wanted to crash in the face of Snow-Covering Mountains because they're way too strong, so we nerfed him a little bit. Alright, so our Snapcaster's neutered here by Relic of Progenitus. Didn't find that white sorcerer we're looking for to have access to Supreme Verdict. I think we're just gonna put the Snapcaster in the bottom. The Spreading Seas is sort of like a cantrip and turns off one of their red lands. Like, it's not unreasonable if we can draw multiples more and somehow our opponent doesn't have multiple more red sources. It's basically like a cantrip. We're basically looking to draw the following card next turn. I think if I got the spell right now, I'd for sure keep the Spreading Seas, but given that I don't, I just want to hold up Cryptic on the turn after, so I'm just going to bottom this also and just play an island. Card went straight into my hand, like if it were a sleight of hand, I definitely would have kept the Spreading Seas and went ahead there and used it on a Snow-Covered Mountain. But given that it doesn't, I don't think it's worth it trying to draw that and then not having Cryptic Command up against whatever nonsense our opponent's going to cast here. Alright, Eternal Scourge is perfectly fine. A little annoying, granted they have Relic of Progenitus on the battlefield, but once we get this Elspeth out there, she'll do the dirty work of dealing with this annoying 3-3. Alright, unfortunately, we have still failed to find second white source. We do need to find it for Elspeth here. In the meantime, however, we'll try to set up a Cryptic counter draw. I assume our opponent's going to crack their Mindstone. Seems like they're a little bit on the flooded side. Alright, no hasty dragons. We can take three for a little while here, just because Elspeth does a fantastic job of controlling the board, especially if she's going to be followed up by a Supreme Verdict to deal with any hasty dragons that try to come down and finish her off. Alright, perfect. We're going to get to Cryptic Command, the Chandra. We'll counter draw here. Again, just trying to find a white source. Found, I believe, the second to last island in the deck. Alright, get out of here, Cryptic. Another Mana Leak, huh? Yeah, well, the Mana Leak's not too bad. If we find a Flooded Strand, a Scalding Tarn, a Hallowed Fountain, all of those draws are going to be fantastic. I think we'll probably just turn the game on its head and our opponent's going to get pummeled into the ground here, but we're going to need to find it, not relatively quickly, but it's certainly not something we can just lollygag around for multiple turns about. Alright, Pian Cairn Nalar. Ooh, if I had a white source, I'd for sure let this resolve. I think given that I don't, I'm going to counter this. I'm not a big fan of countering like the medium creatures in this matchup when you have so many wrath effects. But I don't think this is a spot where I want to just let it resolve. If I could untap and cast Elspeth, I'm going to take that opportunity. Alright, so not going to get there, so we'll go ahead and Serum Visions here. Alright, perfect. So we found Sphinx's Revelation and a Cryptic Command on top. So we can get ourselves into a spot where next turn, so we're going to play the Celestial Colonnade, that gets us to 6 mana. Next turn we can play Island Elspeth. The following turn we can Supreme Verdict with Cryptic up because we have two additional lands in our hand, that gets us to 8 mana. And then after that we can hold up Sphinx's Revelation. So I'm going to go ahead and top. Doesn't really matter the order particularly. Play this Colonnade, ship back to our opponent. And because we have a second Verdict here, we're in a spot where if we need to reevaluate, we can also reevaluate and just Verdict our opponent. So really hoping for no Planeswalker here. Yeah, we'll eat our Serum Visions. No Planeswalkers. Rats. Alright, well, that's a Chandra. Chandra's gonna do some reasonable work. We're now at 9. Go ahead and get down Elspeth. Get out her little friends here. If our opponent has 3 removal spells, they can kill Elspeth. Was not something I was really concerned with. Much more concerned with our opponent, like, plussing Chandra, getting a Stormbreath Dragon out, we have to chump block the Eternal Scourge, Elspeth goes to 1, then we have to, like, attack with Soldier into Chandra, Verdict the board, or I guess Soldier at them, Verdict the board, and then, like, Cryptic their Chandra, so they have to recast it, but the line of thinking there is if they do run both the creatures at Elspeth, we could attack with Soldier Colonnade at Chandra and be willing to trade our board for our opponents. However, we would lose to an additional copy of Chandra in that world. Alright, opponent's coming in with just the Eternal Scourge. Definitely just going to chump block here to threaten the Colonnade plus Soldier's beatdowns into Chandra to finish her off. Alright, opponent is going to bolt us. Redirect Elspeth, and then they'll plus Chandra, and then redirect Elspeth is my assumption. Nope, they're double bolting. So they could have put us to 1 here. Chose not to, which I find a little interesting. Okay, so we're gonna add red mana to their pool. They casting Anger of the Gods? This might be like an Anger of the Gods. A cough. Ooh. All right. So they have 2 walkers, 1 away from ultimate here. Kind of a dicey spot now. We're at 9. My inclination now... Like, we can try to attack one of these planeswalkers off the battlefield with a colonnade. We could try to do something where we colonnade at Koth, one soldier at Chandra, but if our opponent's last card is Scred, they're going to be able to kill our colonnade, and then we still can't even verdict on the follow-up. Which I'm not a big fan of that. We could just, like, set up Sphinx's Revelation for 5. In that world, what I would want to do... probably attack the Koth for 1. I think that's better than attacking Chandra for 1. No, I guess hitting the Chandra for 1 allows me to threaten both of them, but I'm much more afraid of a Koth emblem than I am. Well, I'm afraid of both emblems. Just terrified of both emblems. Both emblems will just defeat me, but I think I have a higher likelihood of preventing a Chandra from exploding than a Koth. Alright, so I think my plan here is I'm going to attack with one of these at Koth of the Hammer. And I'll leave the... Oh, it takes 7, this is 9. Sphinx of Revelation for 5 gets me to 14. I guess maybe I should just cast the Sphinx Revelation main phase and accept that I was discarding a card that might have been better. Alright, well, never fear. Let's harass the Koth for 1. This might also bait the opponent into, like, Scredding the Soldier token, thinking they have lethal. Feels pretty unlikely to me, but... Alright, so let Koth take it. One of my hopes here is that I'm able to Celestial Colonnade the Koth to death, and then Cryptic bounce the Chandra, but we'll see how likely that actually is. Alright, as expected, opponent attacks with both. We'll go ahead and block the Mountania here. Is there a reason to rev here so we don't get double bolted? Obviously, we're dead if our opponent had it last time, so I don't think there is. So our opponent had 2 bolts the turn before and could have just put us to 1 with a Chandra. Play another land. That's fine by me. Alright, I will rev in response to this. And 5. Alright, let's go to 11. See what we can find here. Gideon's pretty good. A Blood Moon. Jeez, I don't have any white mana. That's bad. Fair enough. Alright, well, that takes us off the Celestial Colonnades dealing with, these emblems, so that ends pretty poorly for us. Can Cryptic get off the battlefield? One blue short of being able to double Cryptic even. So we might have to do here, send the soldier token at the Chandra. Yeah, soldier token at the Chandra, Jace plus Cryptic, tap their team, bounce. Probably the Koth. I guess we could let them attack and we could like, I guess, first of all, we need to attack with this token, so let's just do that first. That's to prevent Chandra from ultimating, so we're going to find out pretty quickly whether or not they have a Scred. So attack Chandra. Okay, so they do have a Scryd. Okay. So we could do in the face of this, what I'm leaning towards is counter this, bounce the Blood Moon. Bouncing the Blood Moon allows us to then play Gideon Jura and fetch a basic Plains. And with that, we can then plus targeting our opponent. We've got a Gideon that's locked onto the battlefield. Unless our opponent goes Chandra plus, Koth plus, run into, and attack with Eternal Scourge, which I guess they're very likely to do. So that doesn't even end fantastically for us. So I guess that leaves us back in the same spot as before, where I'd rather counter this. This is a fun spot. Fun spot to try to navigate out of. I almost wish now I'd just read that first card and attacked the Koth for one and look to bounce the Chandra. I guess the other line here is I can counter this and target the Scourge for the bounce to put it into exile. Alright, I think I like that the most. So let's counter and return the Scourge. Returning the Scourge is going to put it into exile. So we still have a target here on the stack for the Scryd, which is still going to allow our Cryptic to counter the Scryd. Meaning our 1 point of damage hits the Chandra, so she doesn't ult next turn. Play out this land. Play this Jace. Gonna try to plus the Jace, I believe, to force my opponent to run into this. Is that better than just minusing? No, I don't think it is. So we should minus this Jace. Alright, so plain Snapcaster and pass. So the Snapcaster is weak, but because of the relic. The pass pretty medium, but could stop a mountain from hitting us. But we obviously need the plains here. So it's possible our opponent selects to put the plains in its own pile. And the snap and the path together. If they split land spells, I will take the spells pile. Let's just check, make sure we have one more Cryptic Command left after this. Alright, so I'm going to choose to take pile one into my hand. The plane's in the bottom of my library, and I'm going to discard the Spreading Seas, I think. Is that better than discarding a Wrath? No, I'll discard a Wrath. I might want the Spreading Seas, I guess. No, I'll discard Spreading Seas. I'm off it. Alright. So opponent should plus Chandra here, likely kill Jace, and then cough a mountain to hit us down to 7. Ooh, P and Kieran Alar. Opponent's going to cast that one instead, and then kill the Jace with the cough. Later, Jace. And you can eat my Spreading Seas. Alright, so opponent's about to ult both their walkers here, so we're in a pretty horrific spot. Let's see. We have 4, 9, 10 lands. So if we use the first cryptic to tap their team, bounce the Blood Moon, We can then attack one of the walkers. We can snapcaster, bounce the other in their upkeep. And the relic is still sitting there, so that doesn't work. Supreme Verdict, and then die to the two walker emblems. Alright, I think our opponent's got us here. I don't see a way out of this. Yeah, well, that's kind of brutal. Alright, well played by our opponent. That Chandra there on turn 7, I think it was really rough. It's possible I'm supposed to plus the Jace the turn previously. Could have played the Gideon a turn. There's probably some way to actually win that game there that I'm not certain where it was. Alright, Flyer Package is fantastic here. They do die to bolts, but we don't really have any creatures for them in game 1. Purges are obviously fantastic. They're, you know, all red spells. Dismember deals a dragon. Detention Sphere helps to deal with some of their crazy Planeswalker action here. Spreading Seas, we can get them all out of the deck. Spell Snare is pretty mediocre. Hits like Mindstone. Can hit Chalice of the Void if they're on that, but not something I'm like super into. Path to Exile is also pretty poor in this matchup. A Stormbreath Dragon has pro white. We do want the extra copy of Negate. And that's bringing us 8 in right now, so we're going to have to leave one extra of these cards in. The Supreme Verdicts are all pretty mediocre. So now it's basically like a matter of, do we want to keep like an extra Blessed Alliance? Would we rather have like a singleton copy of Spreading Seas? Would we rather have the Spell Snare on the play? All in all, these cards are just pretty average in the Scred Red matchup. I think I'm into no Blessed Alliance and 2 Spreading Seas. Just having the extra cantrips. They're not super effective, but I think I'd rather have the cantrips than just mediocre reactive cards. The Wraths are better suited to, even though they're awkward with the Spellcallers here, they're better suited to with like the Peel Kiras and the Stormbreath Dragons of the world. Yeah, I'll trumble with this. Super interesting game 1. I'm wondering if there still was a way out of it. Alright, well, this hand is pretty nice. We will definitely keep it. Drew both of our Spreading Seas here, which is a little silly. Let's see what I'd like to lead here. I'm going to lead Flooded Strain, getting to their Hallowed Fountain. Actually, I might just get a basic island. Probably better around Blood Moon to have one island and one plains here. Alright, get ourselves the island. Go ahead and blow up this land. Unlikely this keeps our opponent off of anything for the short period of time, but you can ever color screw a monocolored opponent, you feel like a boss. Alright, Mindstone right on schedule. Could de-sphere the Mindstone. I think I'm more likely to want to play this tapped Hallowed Fountain and Spreading Seas again, as all my opponent's walkers are all double red. So let's Spreading Seas that to Oblivion. I didn't see the Spreading Seas plan coming through, but I'm glad we left 2 in. Just draw both of them. I think it's a better plan in the play than I thought it was. Get the Hallowed Fountain out there. Opponent can't really run out any of their sweet 4 mana threats here. They're on UUU red colorless. It'd be kind of sweet if they like Thought Not Seeress. Ooh, Ratchet Bomb. Well, we can let the Ratchet Bomb take up for another turn or two. Right, I think my plan here is I'm gonna run out this island and in my opponent's draw step I'll click them. Ooh, the opponent's cracking the Mind Stone. That's good for us. I was even considering Detentions hearing that. Alright, let's get some click action online. Not usually a big fan of this card, but definitely need it for combo decks. And some matchups you need a 3-1 flyer with Flash. I'll definitely take anything that sort of disrupts a combo deck. Alright, what you got, opponent? Stormbreath, Scred, Rabblemaster, Koth, Bolt. So our hand is really weak to these two dragons. I feel like I can interact with this Koth pretty reasonably. I might actually just be most concerned with the Rabble Master plus Bolt play. Like getting to kill our guy and run a Rabble Master. Plus 4 loyalty. Yeah, I think a Koth is fine. Like they run out Koth, they plus and then they bolt our guy. That's also annoying actually. We have to de-sphere and we don't have a way to deal with these two Storm Breaths. Alright, fine. We'll take this Koth for now. Our opponent's hand is quite nice. Oh, it doesn't write it down. I always forget this. So 2S, 2X Dragon, Bolt, Scred, Rabble, and they played the Snow Cover Mount, so I wouldn't write that down. Alright, so there's the Rabble. It's rabbling all around. Definitely won't block that. Yeah, they bolt our guy, perfectly fine by me. Another Queller. Not fantastic. I'm kind of looking to find myself some copies of Supreme Verdict. I think here I'm going to look to flash in I was going to flash in Snapcaster, the Ratchet Bomb on 2 makes it a little more tricky. So I guess it's probably correct to flash in Queller to try to eat the Rabble, because this thing's going to be a 4 power. Expect my opponent to then scred it, because it looks like they've missed the land drop necessary to get the dragon online. Yeah, I'm pretty happy if this thing just gets killed. Do need to find a verdict, however. We also need a way to deal with these two dragons in our opponent's hand. Expect this to get scredoed. Get scredoed. Again, not flashing in Snapcaster here because it'll clear both of my opponent's mountains and just die to the Ratchet Bomb. And Blood Moon. Well, that's fine. We've got enough basics. Well, Negate's not going to do much either. I think I'm going to go ahead and de-sphere the Rabble Master. This way, if they want to take the Ratchet Bomb up to 3D, the Rabble Master back, I can just... It kills their Blood Moon also. It does, like, free the Rabble Master from an attack, which is a little awkward, but... This might just be terrible, actually. The joys of playing against Goblin Rabble Master again. It has been a while. It might just be incorrect to just leave their Rabble Master hidden here under a sphere for them. Alright, so they're going to tick up. Again, their hand is Dragon, Dragon, Unknown. Alright, so crack that. Free from the Blood Moon. So this is going to get them an extra Gabarino, a Relic I'll let resolve. I don't expect the Snapcaster really to do too much. Alright, we'll get rid of Flooded Strand. I really just want to eat some goblins, and I was hoping my opponent might play another spell there pre-combat. As unlikely as it may be. Let's go ahead and claw one of these goblins. Fall to 10. Double Storm Breath and an Unknown. Dismember. Well, that's going to deal with a dragon pretty effectively. Now I wish I'd quartered the Relic.
It's probably wrong, not Quell of the Relic. Whoopsie daisy.
This matchup against Scred Red feels quite tough. Like, you just need to have one of your big threats, and just every one of their cards is a haymaker. I certainly don't believe that I've played the matchup super well, but. Alright, get out of here, D-Sphere. Another Mountania. Alright, well, we're gonna get to Snapcaster Dismember. So they're not running out of dragon. We'll let this happen. Interesting, not sending that, so. Don't know what this insinuates. I'm gonna fall to 8. Means I can't Snapcaster Dismember now for value. Feels like my opponent's just trying to, like, hard represent that they're trying to play on Cryptic. I think I need to hold this Dismember still. Alright, well, I did find the Cryptic, so that's a little awkward. Alright, we'll pass back to our opponent. We're going to Dismember their Goblin Rabbit Master, I guess, in beginning of combat. Or not in beginning of combat, in main phase, so it doesn't trigger. But it's not cracking the relic here. That's super surprising. Mind Stone. I don't particularly care about a Mind Stone. I care about negating terrifying planeswalkers. Alright, let's go ahead and get rid of that guy. Puts us to 4 in a spot. We're dead to a bolt, and we're dead to either of the giant monsters eating us here. Ricochet Trap. You're a Dismember. Alright, well, I guess I'll burn a negate on that, because I need the Cryptic for the dragons. This makes more sense now, is what was going on. So my opponent now does not have to suicide a goblin to put us to 3 if they don't want to. I highly recommend they do, though. It's a great play for us. Be very kind of them. Alright. Sphinx's Revelation. Well, if I had to choose to draw a brick, that would be a good brick to draw. Almost assuredly just Crypticking this first dragon. Alright, counter draw. Just pop our graveyard out here as we're gonna keep getting relic'd. Colony, not bad, not great. Certainly take it. Remember, of note, we can't actually block the Stormbreath Dragon here with this Queller, unfortunately. So it looks like we're gonna have to rev for 3 here to survive. So I'm not gonna use the Serum Visions just yet. Again, leaving back the Queller, just want to hold back these goblins as long as possible. Yeah, would have played it a lot better if we realized how this game was going to pan out further and had Quellered this relic. That's on me. Whoopsie daisy. Pion Kirin Nalar. That I think I get to let resolve. I mean, I could try to run out Snapcaster to Crypticate, and then try to get them to pop the relic. Yeah, I think I'm just into revving. So now they're in a spot with another mana source, they can start running these goblins in and then throwing the Thopters. We're also sort of in a spot now where we have to rev into a verdict and then find a way to deal with a dragon. Any verdicts ever. Uh-oh. Well, Mana Leak does deal with a dragon. However, we still don't have a Supreme Verdict. So we have enough mana and correct colors. Just gonna Serum Visions here, hope to find a Supreme Verdict. It's So resist memory verdict on top. And we need an untapped land here to be able to animate Colonnade and hold up Mana Leak, so play this Tech Edge. And ship the turn back. Looks like a pretty easy attack for my opponent. Looks like I have to block Pian Kirin. Alright, so them popping Mind Stone, does that allow us to do anything? Doesn't look like it. Can't really Snapcaster back anything of value there in the end step. So they don't have access to two different... Now they do again. I was going to say, they don't have access to two different flings here with Pian Kirin. But now they do once more. Alright, opponent is sending everybody. Looks like I want to... Probably... I think just animate the Colonnade. If I animate the Colonnade, block the Pian Kirin Alarm, block a Goblin, taking three, they can fling at me, and I'm really taking six. Yeah, I think that's my best bet. Alright, you can eat my Serum Visions. Toss this here and this on this. Should actually reverse that. That way our opponent doesn't just fling an artifact at both of our things. So this way, if they want to fling two things here with their Pian Kirin Alar to deal us two damage each, they deal two damage with the Relic, two damage with the Thopter, then only two damage in combat, putting us to one. And then we're actually in a spot where we don't end up to Supreme Verdict. Another sweet little game. One that I'm likely to run out of time in. Thanks to the power of Snow Covered Mountain. Remember, we still know about a Storm Breath in our opponent's hand. Two unknowns. Waiting to pay costs. Alright, here we go. Let's see what they're gonna fling at. Assume they're flinging this Relic at us. Alright, flinging it at us. Alright, letting combat damage happen. So we're gonna fall to two. And a Ratchet Bomb. Well, I need this Mana Leak pretty heavily for the Dragon, so I'm gonna hold on to it. Have to burn the Supreme Verdict here. I think I can now get away with Mana Leaking and Snapcaster Crypticking. So I think I can actually get away with just playing this Colonnade and shipping back to my opponent. Playing this game like a little loose aggressive at this point, but I think we're actually in an okay position. I don't think we're okay position in the match given our time clock, but that's not something we're gonna play around at this point. All right. Certainly gonna let our opponent go to combat here. They are jamming. We will jam our Snapcaster. And I'm just going to line up block and not Rev just yet. But I'm going to target the Revelation. I think this is better than trying to like bounce my Snapcaster with Cryptic in this matchup. Alright. Block your goblin, block your Thopter. Code one. Chandra, jeez. Well, that's not the card I would have picked my opponent to have as the last card in their hand, so that's great. It's rev for three in response. Alright, well, we found some dicey, or some sweet ones here. Hopefully we can get our opponent to a dicey spot, but... Alright, adding red-red, and they're just going to play their dragon. Okay. Well, I think we can beat all of that. So to beat all of that, we can play Supreme Verdict. Verdict. Play Gideon. Yeah. You can add a counter, that's fine. Play Gideon. Plus Gideon targeting our opponent. Pass back to them. So we can kill that Chandra and be at two with Mana Leak Cryptic in our hand. Problem here is our clock at this point. I don't think we're going to be able to fight that. I think we might be able to win this game. Alright, opponent immediately cracks the Relic, just wants to get another card. Plays a Mountain. So it looks like we pretty easily have this game under lock. Let's pop this now. That's a snow card. Alright, well, let's yield to that, yield to that. Not a snow card, alright. Zero Gideon. Play a Strand, F6. Attack with all creatures at Chandra. Alright. Well, we reduced our opponent's resources to zero. I'm calling that a victory. Makes me wonder if there was a way to get win game one here. Goblin Dark Dwellers, yeah, not happening. 4-4 Menace, no thank you. Full Mana Leak it. Run out of Queller. Try to get our opponent dead a little faster here. Maybe we can speed magic through the last game. Crack that. Attack with all these for 12. Alright, and this leaves Cryptic up. Cryptic this. Alright, well, we managed to win game two. Which, A, is sweet. B, sucks when our clock's at a minute and 20, basically 8 here when this game's gonna end. Alright. Managed to grind through all of that. I don't think I sequenced well there, that second spell Queller. And how to actually fight through the Rival Master. It was really important that our opponent gave us respect for a Cryptic, and then we were able to find one by the time that they couldn't play around it anymore. I think that's just a pretty clear sort of sign of just, like, playing around cards that you won't be able to play around the entire time. I think in reality, the best way to play against Cryptic Command is just to jam every single time, just hope your opponent doesn't have as many of them as humanly possible. Alright, is there any way we can win any faster? That's really what we're looking for here. And in reality, I don't really see that. Nope, I think we have the fastest list possible submitted. So, minute 28, we're going to be on speed magic. We'll see if we can play as fast as we possibly can. Kill our opponent on like turn 5 here with our sweet blue-eyed control deck. Yep, this is an easy keep. We've got Queller, The good old Queller Supreme Verdict combo, not one that I highly recommend. Opponent's going down on card, that's good for us. Keeping six. And left it on top. And starting off right with a relic. Alright, well, we're going to really need to find a basic planes here. Our hand is pretty susceptible here to a Blood Moon on three on the play. Ooh, this fast relic Mindstone start. Not a great place for us to be. There's the Blood Moon. Alright, so we got some islands and some mountains. And a negate right on turn three. Rats. Well, thankfully our opponent doesn't have another land, so we can get a negate off here on an important spell. We can get back into it. Another Blood Moon. I think I'm fine with that. That's fine. We just need to find some planeses here. A single planes will get rid of both of these Blood Moons, which will be nice. Another relic's not something I really care to fight over. Fortunately, we're going to discard to hand size here. I think we're going to discard one of these Million Wraths. Eternal Scourge, that's not something we can really fight over. Another Tap Mountain. Really wish it would just default to the one card you have in the cases of Relic. The minigame of having to click it bothers me when I'm at 46 seconds. Alright, getting bashed here for three of us. Scourge. Hopefully opponent just has a Planeswalker follow-up that we can negate here. Second Mindstone will let happen. Come on, big Plains action. Ooh, another island. Does island do anything? No, it does not. Alright. Good old six white cards and a negate. Darn you, negate. Darn you. Well, I think if we could cast this Gideon, we can get into it, but that might not be happening here. Another Mindstone from our opponent. This does seem like a game that I would say we're actually not that far behind in if we had enough time to play it all the way out. Because eventually we are going to find a way to basically interact with most of our opponent's board. Yep, crack another Mindstone. I'm going to be discarding a Queller here. That's a cough. We'll negate that. Alright. Planes for Detention Sphere. Come on. Alright, don't deserve it enough. Fair enough, fair enough, fair enough. At least we don't discard hand size this turn. It's always a plus. Rabble Master. Well, that probably kills us. Yeah, we could Detention Sphere here into a Verdict. We do find a Plains. A Detention Sphere into a Verdict would do some stuff, but... Alright, well, that's going to do it for us. Both on the timeout and the actual death. GG's to our opponent. Scred Red doing it again. Blood Moon there was, like, kind of hard to beat in Game 3. I think that our hand can usually get around it from the spot that we were in. Like, yeah, we board out some number of cantrip effects, like the Spreading Seas. But, like, we had access to the Detention Sphere, so it was just a matter of finding one of the three planes. Obviously, that's not that many outs, but the game was going to go a realistically long time if our opponent had the third turn three Blood Moon, which they did. Outside of that, I think there might have been a way to win Game 1. I think the only mistake we made in Game 2 is not spell coloring the second Relic of Progenitus our opponent ran out. sort of made our Snapcaster a dangling card in our hand for most of the rest of the game until our opponent couldn't actually get across the corner there, losing most of their threats to Cryptic Commands. So there might have been a better way to play game one, but in all, we're 1-1 now, and I will see you back for round number three. All right, after a grueling round two, back here on the play for round number three with blue-white control. This hand's fantastic. Definitely keep this hand. Not going to lead on the Serum Visions. I'm going to lead on the tap land of Colonnade here so we can figure out what we need before we start messing with our opponent's strategy here and just trying to stall up before we can take over with some sweet Planeswalkers. Basic Island. Uh-oh. Delver. Whoa. Alright, well, if that's the case, I'm going to plan to get the Supreme Verdict off. Snapcaster and Cryptic. I think I'm actually just going to bottom both of these. I just really want to hit my land drops. I'm not going to path this Delver. Would rather my opponent build out a bigger board. Hopefully Delver doesn't flip. If it does, it's a little bit more annoying. We're going to take a bit more damage here before we Wrath it away. Alright, they flip it and they reveal a Sleight of Hand. Very lucky, very lucky. Alright, so I'd expect this is probably blue-red Delver. That being the case, Supreme Verdicts here are pretty much our most important cards. We want to just keep clearing the board, not let them stick any threats, and then once we have more mana available to pay for things like Logic Knot slash Mana Leak, get into situations where we're fighting with our more, I guess, flexible spells will be the word I'll use, rather than more expensive ones. Like, I'm getting into fights here with Path and Snapcaster in the mid and late game, rather than trying to just jam Planeswalkers out on curve, as those are much more likely to get countered. Second Island's pretty annoying, as we're just not spreading seizing any of these things. Alright, did find a Flooded Strand. Probably gonna end up using that here. Yeah, we'll use that. We'll probably fetch a basic island with this. Get a basic plains from our hand. That way, if our opponent happens to be blue-red Blood Moon Delver, won't get got by any nonsense there. Again, not looking to Wrath away just yet. Or sorry, to Path away just yet. Would rather find a Wrath here. Or spot two Wrath, preferably, if our opponent will give us another threat. If our opponent doesn't give us another threat here, however, and does play a red land, I'm much more likely to, like, path here in the end step, and then try to set up a situation where we can Spreading Seas their other land, and move along with our lives from there. Top, no land. Top, no land. So I could path away, and then Spreading Seas the land they get. Kinda into that if we don't get Spell Snared. I'm gonna feel kinda silly if I get Spell Snared. Alright, I am gonna go for this. Under the logic of I don't want my opponent to get the two things they've left on top, and I think if I can turn all their lands into islands, I'd be pretty happy. Says our opponent's waiting to cast a spell here. Huh. Not really sure what spell our opponent could be looking to cast here other than, like, dispel. Yeah, okay. So main deck dispels, huh? Not gonna crack the fetch here. I would like to draw a fifth land. Alright, well, now we have to make a decision on whether or not we want to path away the top of our opponent's library or just Wrath away this Delver. I think I want our opponent to have to commit to getting more stuff on the board. That way, if we draw another land for this Gideon, we can just slam it. So I'm just gonna Wrath away. get the Delver off the battlefield. I think this sets us up the best way to possibly resolve a Gideon on the next turn. Thought Scour themselves, milling Logic Knot into second Thought Scour. Interesting. So it looks like they topped a Logic Knot, hoping that they could just protect. So we bricked on a land here, unfortunately. So we'll go and Serum Visions. Our opponent did top a card, so I'd expect one of those to be a land. Unfortunately, did not draw the land off the Serum, and it's also a tap land. I'm going to top both of these. I'm going to try to draw the land next turn. Going to look to Snapcaster Path, whatever our opponent plays this turn. Alright, Polluted Delta, what is your second color? Are you literally Mono Blue Delver? Blue Blue for Cryptic Serpent. Sure, that can resolve. Alright, a little snappy dude, do you resolve? Alright, I'm gonna guess this Path to Exile will not be resolving, however. Looks like our opponent's on some cool, like, mono blue, blue black, blue red spells kind of nonsense. Their deck looks pretty cool. Interesting, the path resolved. More basic islands. Alright, well, under that assumption, I'm really expecting my opponent to not have any lands for the Spreading Seas. So yeah, I'm just going to run this out, draw the other Snapcaster to the top of our library, just start churning through cards. Perfectly fine with my mana base, I'm not going to Spreading Seas myself there. And something we don't do pretty often, starting the beatdown train. $17, $15. Dismember your Snapcaster. Yeah, that's fine. I'd rather negate a real spell. Like, I think even if my opponent runs out, like, a good cantrip this turn, I might counter it. Another Cryptic Serpent. A little annoying. Another Cryptic Command. Alright, what do I want to do here? My initial thought is just pass. I think that's what I'm going to do. And then set up a spot where I can bounce the Cryptic Serpent on end step and try to draw a card. So I just want to try to resolve this Gideon as badly as possible. Alright, start six cards in hand, return to your permanent, draw a card. Don't expect this Cryptic Command resolve based on the spells my opponent's playing. Seems like they're like a very high density of like protection spells. Spell, Logic Knot. I mean, we could see something even as, like, Apostle's Blessing. That could be a card in our opponent's deck. I would expect this is a deck that, like, once they get a threat into play, if we can't just keep answering all of their threats as they come up, I think that we're going to fall behind. And currently that's the spot we're in. Alright, looks like we're going to get Logic Knotted here, because my opponent's tapped 2 mana and nether. They're deep in the tank. Alright, Logic Knot X equals 2. Don't want to pay 2 mana for that. You can get out of here, Cryptic. The Cryptic Command leaves us in a very similar spot, unfortunately. So I think, again, I'm going to go for the the bounce the serpent on end step line if our opponent doesn't do anything. Thought Scour target yourself. That's fine. Build a Remand and a Delver. Alright, so I'm going to take this hit going to 1. That is going to turn off future fetch lands and future like dismembers, but I think that's our best bet to get this Gideon down, which I think Gideon's probably a showstopper for them. Alright, return your snake. Get out of here, serpent. Again, I don't assume that this card's going to resolve. Alright, so Snapcaster Dispel here is what I'm assuming is going on. Yep. Alright, well, I think our best bet here is just Snapcaster Wrath, but I don't expect that to work either. I think what we could do is you could lead on Snapcaster and not play the land yet. I think that gives our opponent the least likely opportunity that they counter the Snapcaster, because they don't think that we can Wrath then. Yeah, so they do have a Spell Snare. So I think we have to negate the Spell Snare, Serum Visions, and Serum Visions into a path. I think it's our highest likelihood of winning rather than holding up trying to Cryptic. So I don't think that we're going to be able to beat 5 mana up with 3 cards in hand. Yeah, I think it's a higher likelihood that this works out. In our line, we can't beat any counter spells. On this line, we can at least win in the world in which we get there. Well, I don't believe that world's very likely, of course. Like, we only have, what, 3 paths left? Blessed Alliance, you're a little too late, friend. There was a path, however. That's unfortunate. Alright. Let our opponent go through the motions, see if they want to show us any additional cards here. We are dead. Alright, so it looks like just a mono blue spells deck here. Rest in Peace should be pretty fantastic. Dispel, click, Rest in Pieces. Blessed Alliance looks good, actually. It's possible our opponent boards into a bunch of Planeswalkers, though. Basically just becomes a blue fish deck. Cryptic Command's pretty slow, don't really want to battle with that. Possibly with these Quellers here. These Mana Leaks look pretty weak. Our opponent is Mana Light, but it's also a thing of they're going to leverage their mana much better than we are. These Spreading Seas are just truly horrendous against a mono blue deck. Our opponent could have like Mutavault and stuff, but let's for sure get these 6 in. Snake 8 doesn't even look that great to me. Our opponent brings in a bunch of, like, Planeswalkers, however they're gonna look good. Let's see. The Quellers are good in the Counter Wars. That's probably worth enough equity to bring some number of them in. Revelation, how bad are you? You seem okay. It's probably just nice to have another Haymaker draw. I don't really want to board out a Tectonic Edge, but I've just boarded out a bunch of cantrips. Alright, I think I'm going to not play this click. And let's board down. Board down 1 Snapcaster, we're bringing in 3 Rest in Peace. Could go down to 1, that might be better. Let's go down to 1 and leave 1 Cryptic. Alright, I expect both decks to basically present like fish decks here. Alright, this hand's pretty great. So removal, counterspell early, serum visions to try to hit us on land drops. Wonder if our opponent's playing any, like, any of the blue sort of delve threats. Seems plausible. Let's see. So we could... Yeah, I'm not going to play the Flooded Strand yet, so I would prefer to not have to fetch a Hallowed Fountain. So I'm going to leave the Mana Leak. By just playing Tectonic Edge. The reason not to play Strand here is you don't want to have to commit yourself to getting second blue or second white. Obviously, you can get both by getting a Hallowed Fountain, but then you're committing yourself to taking 3 points of damage, and that's not really something I'm keen on doing. I'm probably going to Mana Leak if my opponent cast any reasonable Magic the Gathering card this turn. Thought Scour, I'd probably counter any random 2-drop blue threat. Serum Visions I might even counter. Yeah, I think I'll get rid of this. I just want to stop my opponent's ability to, like, card flow, and I think I just want to sort of trade my mana for my opponent's mana right now. So I'm definitely going to be the one with better cards in the late game. Unfortunately, I have a second Serum Visions. I was hoping just for a sleight of hand. Keep one, bottom the other. Alright, so that is going to be a flip Delver. Is this a turn to rest in peace? Like, it's nice to get it to resolve, however, it's more a question of whether or not it's more important to resolve this than get ahead on the board state. I think that's probably more important. So let's just go ahead and path this Delver right this second. We're going to see if our opponent's spell is, like, worth not getting a land. I expect them to get an island. Okay, so they do. We go to 16 and we'll rest in peace here. Again, what I was talking about earlier, the Flooded Strand no longer applies as we're... Ooh, we're getting surgical on our paths. Alright, I guess that was a reason to read on the rest in peace then. Alright, fair enough. Hopefully it gets our opponent pretty good here, though. They're going to have, like, surgical still in their deck, and we're going to have rest in peace. So they're looking to fight a graveyard battle, and we're looking to just not involve the graveyard in the match. A little less great that we're not going to have any paths. This Detention Sphere is going to be pretty important if our opponent ever gets to... Goodness gracious, I didn't know what the converted mana cost from Cryptic Serpent is. I guess it's 8, because it's... should be 6 UU. Alright, so no more paths for us. That's a little annoying. But we are going to be leveraging the Spell Caller here really effectively, as our opponent's sort of trapped playing a small ball game with us, and I think they're going to struggle without finding a cheap threat here to fight through the Queller. Ooh, and a Wrath. Alright, well, now I'm even more incentivized to just Serum Visions. Another Serum Visions. Do I want a Snare or a Blasted Alliance? No, I don't really want either of those. We can get rid of those. Serum Visions again. If our opponent wants a Logic, not that, they can. Two Colonnades and an Elspeth. Yeah, I'll keep the two Colonnades. Gonna be a little slow and steady here out of the gate. Our opponent can start flashing in Snapcasters and nonsense like that. But now our plan is just to build up to the Sun's Champion here. Alright, your nice calm game of Magic the Gathering where no one casts any spells. Sixth Island for our opponent. We'll get our next land down. If our opponent ever gets into a spot where they just tap out for, like, a Cryptic Serpent, seeing as that's their best threat, and we just get to Elspeth minus and kill it, it's going to be pretty much a disaster scenario for our opponent. All right, they're correctly milling us with Thought Scour. They milled over two lands. That's kind of rude. One of the nice plays there with Thought Scour is once you no longer can fill up your graveyard, you may as well start exiling cards from your opponent's library. All right, we find the island. Again, I'm not just going to run at the Elspeth here. I don't want to run into counter magic. I can pretty reliably let my opponent just run out of Cryptic Serpent because we're pretty confident with their low threat density deck, if they find a serpent and they think that they can start moving, we'll just let them do it. Okay, so Cryptic Serpent 7. That resolves. And perfect. And the Sun's Champion is here to fight. If you didn't play with Elspeth in Standard, you really missed out. This card is just really great. Alright, my opponent's pretty much up a creek without a paddle here. Yeah. Yeah, they're off that. Alright, so we'll play better with our Rest in Peace this time as to not get all of our paths caught. You could argue that it ended up working out, but I think that's pretty short-sighted. Alright, do we want any of this nonsense? I think the sizing on click is, like, still medium. Revelation still just does not strike me as a card in the matchup that's going to be, like, hyper-effective. Blessed Alliances seem pretty solid. The Rest in Pieces are okay. Maybe I can get away with an additional copy of Cryptic, but I think my opponent's just a better fish deck than I am, so it's, like, bad to try to get into spots where I'm going to be fighting Counter Wars, because I'm never going to be ahead on the board. Sorry, never is a strong suggestion. I would say very seldom I'll be ahead on the board. Yeah, I don't think I'm particularly into any of these. Again, the reason for not bringing the extra copy into gate is I think it's just going to be mana efficient relative to what the Counter Wars are going to look like. And I think that we're really just fighting a battle over my opponent's creatures relative to my answers, more so than them, like, boarding into a Planeswalker strategy like Jace Architect of Thought. I think one Snapcaster Mage is the right number. I think I'm happy with all of this. Hopefully line up the strategy again of just resolving a Sweet Planeswalker. Yuck. Alright, we're gonna send this one back. I think if this was a Hallowed Fountain, I would consider this hand. Looks like our opponent might be considering their hand also. Yeah, I think if we had the 7 with a Scry, I would also keep it. Alright, so our opponent's going to 6. This hand's also sketchy, but it's certainly a keep. Hopefully we see a land on top. That'd be really nice. Second Rest of Beast. Alright, well, we definitely don't want that one. Hopefully this doesn't turn into, like, a little pedal fight here. We're both, like, mana screwed, because our opponent has a lot more cantrips and the ability to operate off one mana that we don't. So they topped their card. Ooh, nice. That was lucky. So this can get us a tapped Hallowed Fountain that can get us either basic and or a second Hallowed Fountain. I'm gonna play the Tarn out. Expect my opponent to probably Thought Scour here. If they topped their card though, I guess they'd be Thought Scouring me usually. They don't have a Delver. Okay, so they may have topped a Delver. Alright, so considering going down to, like, 15 here, fetching Island and Plains, using the Island try to dismember this, and then using the Plains to cast Rest in Peace. That put us on 14, which is not a great life total. This is definitely not a threat I want sitting on the battlefield if I can help it. Alright, dispelled. They're down to 3 cards left, thankfully. That means our Rest in Peace will resolve here. With Blessed Alliance, too. Alright, I'm just going to fetch a basic here. I think I want to preserve my life total, as I think the game's going to go on long enough that I'll find a way to use this Cryptic. Alright, I just really need you to not flip this turn, Delver. Please not this turn. You can flip on another turn, just not this one. Alright, so didn't flip this time. That's pretty huge for us. And our opponent has another land, so we know they're not just, like, all in flooded on counter spells, which is just great for us. Do another planes. Actually, the preferred basic here, given that we have the Supreme Verdict in our hand. So any one land will get us there. My opponent runs out of Snapcaster here. I think I'd mana leak it. I'd want my opponent to try to fight to get more creatures onto the battlefield so that my Supreme Verdict could even leverage greater dividends. Thought Scour, target themselves in upkeep. So they really don't want whatever card that is on top, which leads me to believe that it's another island. Either that or a Cryptic Serpents. I think I'm going to mana leak this to try to get them to draw that dead card, to try to get them to fight another counter war here over this dead card. So the mana leak resolves, so I'm assuming my opponent's drawing a dead spell here, and or a basic. Because I think if it was a fetch land, I think they might have accepted drawing it. Yeah, so they didn't even play a land, so I'm assuming that's a Cryptic Serpent in their hand. Alright, Serum Visions is nice. Hopefully they can find us some lands action. Supreme Verdict and a Tectonic Edge, so I will probably keep both of these, actually. I have the second Supreme Verdict that I just drew, so let's get rid of the second Supreme Verdict. Let's keep this Tech Edge. Now we've got Kicked Blessed Alliance, we can Supreme Verdict. Hope my opponent just runs out of Snapcaster. That'd make me really happy. Alright, there we go. Now we're doing it. Supreme Verdict getting a 2-for-1. Our opponent has a negate. Our opponent probably feels like they're doing it now. Again, I'm not going to Blessed Alliance here. I'm just going to fall to 7. I think I can get a spot later where I get both effects out of this Blessed Alliance. And I don't think I need to trade mana here when I don't expect my opponent to use their mana, and I expect to use all of my mana. So, no reason to let my opponent use mana when I don't think that they'll be using it for any equity. Uncounterable spell. And second snappy? Sure. Sure. And cycle center. Okay. So, their last card's a negate, and then they cycle an unknown. So, they now have two unknowns, one of which is island they just played. We're going down to 5. Serum Visions. So then I can Serum, look to bait with this Blessed Alliance. Yeah, I think that makes me happy. It's also possible they negate my Serum. Less likely, but plausible. Remand. Oh, that's annoying. Okay. I'm actually fine with that. At least I got to use my mana in some capacity. Not just like completely sinking there, as I don't want to just Supreme Verdict for one thing if I could possibly get two. So I am going to get this Blessed Alliance negated here for sure. I am going to go for the Sacrifice mode rather than the Gain 4 Life mode, even though the Gain 4 Life mode is better for me. The reason for that is that it's going to force the negate out of my opponent if I force them to sack, whereas the Gain 4 Life is not going to force it. And I don't really have any necessity to be at 3 life relative to 5 life or 7 life. Fortunately, my opponent tied both of those cards. That's bad. Target opponent sacrifices an attacking creature. How about you? You don't need that creature. There's the negate. Thought Scour, me milling. Ooh, a Rest in Peace and a Dispel. Thank you, opponent. Ooh, it might be that their top card was Delver. Nice, and then we're just going to get a Verdict that, too. Awesome. Alright. Get your board out of here. We have a Detention Sphere for the next threat. So my opponent knows this top card of their library because they left it on top. So Thought Scour, me again, milling Spell Snare, Hallowed Fountain. So they have no hand left. Nice, alright. Ooh, there's Elspeth. Alright, so we just need to find some lands here. Come on, Serum Visions, do your job. Path and a Snappy. Well, we don't need that Snappy. We're at 3. We can take this Tarn and go to 2 to get one of the Hallowed Fountains. One's left and one's been exiled. Okay. So keep that on top. Do-do-do.
Alright, crack your strand, get another land. Alright. Opponent immediately just shipping it back, as expected. Play our Tarn. So we can't get into a dicey spot here if they manage to find a Snapcaster Mage and we crack this Tarn. It's possible just wanting a basic island with this. Actually, not him thinking about that. So I think I'm actually just going to leave this turn in my hands. I definitely don't want to draw the Snapcash in the bottom of my library. Ooh, a Queller. That's really nice. Alright, definitely keep sitting here. Have insurance against a Serpent, have insurance against Snapcaster. Now we have insurance against a Counterspell. We can also provide the first threat onto the battlefield here. So if my opponent plays basically anything, I'd probably Queller it. Again, I don't have a big incentive here to move, so I'm not going to move just yet. Alright, Revelation gives me a medium incentive to move. I'll probably Rev for 2 on their end step, expecting it to get countered. Opponent's still just passing back. We don't want to let them build up to a spot where they get threatened multiple counters in hand. So let's go ahead and crack this Tarn. Thankfully did not get hit by like a Shadow of Doubt or something silly. Rev for 2, expect this to get countered. We're getting censored, we're getting negated, mana leaked. Repeal the Rest in Peace. Okay. So Repeal's going to allow them to build up a graveyard here again. And then the Rev resolves. Interesting. We didn't draw a land, however. Not finding a land in that bunch makes this a lot trickier. I think the line I want to run with, however, is Jace. Yeah, I think I'm going to run out Jace here. They have 3 cards. Yeah, I think I like running out Jace and minusing Jace. We'll basically take any pile with a land in it. Fail to find such a thing. Opponent's terrified of that spell clause, immediately put it in its own pile. Okay, yeah, I think the Snapcaster is actually the better card here. Okay, so they're just trying to figure out what pile of Serum Visions goes into. They've been moving the Serum Visions back and forth, back and forth. Alright, I'm going to choose to put the Snapcaster pile into my hand, as I think the path is the best card I have. So, I'm going to choose to put that pile into my hand. I think my plans for discarding this turn are going to depend on what my opponent flashes in on end step. So, I expect a click or a Snapcaster or something. Nothing. Okay, so I think I'm going to discard a Gideon. Gideon, Cryptic, and Serum? It's definitely a Gideon and a Cryptic. I guess the next question after that is, am I ever going to actually recast this Rest in Peace? They have 1 Snapcaster, 2 Snapcasters. They have already 2 Snapcasters in exile. And I have 1 Rest in Peace left in my library. It's also possible I just don't need a big card. Like, I could discard, like, Cryptic Elspeth Gideon. Less likely to do that, though. Alright. Yeah, I'm just going to discard Rest in Peace Cryptic Gideon, I think. Yeah, Cryptic, Rip, Gideon. Now I obviously wish I had run out of Gideon, given that my Jace resolved. Expect this to be a Cryptic Serpent.
which on end step here we'll try to path this little guy out of the way. I expected to get any sort of counterspell under the sun. Like, if this just resolved, I'll be ecstatic. I'm almost 100% just run out of Gideon Jura. Alright, so I'm just running out of Gideon Jura this turn. I don't think there's any way you can talk me out of it. Yeah, let's plus Jace. Let's play Flooded Strand just in case. Play Gideon. Alright, so now Gideon's resolved. We're pretty safe except for another repeal. So now the question is, do I want to crack this Flooded Strand and go to 3 to Serum Visions? I think I'm okay too. Yeah, I'm okay too. So I'm gonna go to 3 here. Get an island, visions. Don't need either of these. I don't think I need this colonnade. Yeah, I don't think I need this colonnade. Get out of here, colonnade. Alright, now the extra island though, we've set up Snapcaster Cryptic. Hallowed Fountain, probably not what we needed. Let's see, is there any like super dangerous spot we can get ourselves into by like minusing this Jace and plusing this Gideon, not attacking with it again? I don't think so. I'm just gonna keep drawing cards with my Jace here. Alright, well, I'm probably just gonna take the Wrath Pile. Yeah, I'll just take the Wrath Pile. Don't want to leave up Snapcaster Cryptic. I think I want to leave open Snapcaster Path Queller, so I can play a tap land here. Again, I'm just going to plus Gideon, I'm pretty sure. That might just be too passive, though. Queller, Snap Path, that's two answers. Yeah, I think I'll start attacking next turn. Just playing like super safe. Don't really think there's a reason to move here, as I think it's pretty implausible my opponent can actually like get around me just moving this Gideon up every turn. And I kind of want to build up to a spot where I can just slam Elspeth. Obviously it's pretty difficult through a million counter spells, but I don't have a reason to move when my opponent doesn't have a threat either. Alright, so plus Jace. Play Island. Can animate Gideon pretty safely this turn, giving me a Snapcaster Cryptic plus a Queller, right? 2, 6, 8 mana, so we're 1 mana short. Guess given we live in that world, Serum Visions first. Oh, and negate. Alright, well, we don't need the 4th Wrath, and I'll definitely take the Blessed Alliance. Alright, with the negate and a Queller and a Snapcaster to jump block, yeah, we can attack here. Slow and steady beatdowns from these sweet planeswalkers. Vapor snag your Gideon. Alright, well that's a reason to never animate my Gideon ever again. And I lose a life. Losing a life sucks. Alright, I think I'm gonna negate that. Spell snare your negate. So now the question is, do we want to continue fighting here? I don't think the answer is yes. I think I can just go back to sitting in my own little hole in the ground and not moving. Yeah, I don't think I need to continue fighting here. If I keep fighting, actually, though. I'm the one with the threat on the battlefield, and I actually do want to queller the snare rather than the vapor snag, because it's less likely the snare is going to be effective. Alright, so let's queller the snare. So what do we get got by here? Then we get got by Vendilion Click Plus. Alright, I'm gonna call her this. This might be wrong and I might have actually just killed myself. We'll see. Oof. Alright, yeah, I think I'm gonna die here. So I'm gonna fall to 2, then I'm gonna fall to 1. When it resnares this, the Gideon comes back to my hand. Yeah, I may have gotten myself killed here. Hopefully it doesn't happen. So I'm just dead to a Snapcaster Mage, basically at any point now. Alright, so I think we just cast this for the 4 life that I was expecting to last turn. So let's... I guess we should just do that in their upkeep. There's no reason to do this right this second. Plus Jace. Pass back. So I will fight a counter war over literal 4 life here. Not what you usually do against a blue deck, but... Welcome to the jungle. Target player gains 4 life, I'll choose me. You better bet I'll Snapcaster Mage that too, opponent. It looks like they're signing up a Logic Knot here for this. This is great. Alright, well, that's an awesome way for a mono blue spells deck versus blue white control match to end with a player casting target player gains 4 life on the stack. You don't get many games like that. That was a pretty sweet one. I'll give big props to my opponent. Fighting through that turn 2, rest in peace. They did some serious work there with the repeal. I thought I was going to die to these Vapor Snags and then finding one more Snapcaster Mage here, but I guess the last 4 life here is really going to do it. So we're 2-1 now. We'll go ahead and finish out this league, and thanks for watching, everybody.
Alright, everybody, welcome to the final round here at Blue Light Control. We're on the play. Sweet hand. Snap keep. By sweet hand, I mean obviously we have 3-4 mana spells and 3 lands, so hopefully it's not have happened what happened last game. But those are few and far between, so I'm not too concerned. Godless Shrine. Alright. Could see some tokens. Alright, I will... I'm just going to play the island here. I do want to get a Flooded Strand here, or sorry, a Hallowed Fountain here with my Scalding Tarn, as I need the second White Sword for my Supreme Verdict. Alright, White Black Eldrazi. But I don't really want to use my Fetch Land right here in case I have to Mana Leak. Collective Brutality. Alright, fine, I'll Mana Leak it. Rather protect the Supreme Verdict if possible. Then on the Thought Knots here, I'd much rather have a Supreme Verdict. Now, of course, they usually do, but... Uh-oh, not like this. Not like this. Inquisition. Alright, well, I only have one target, so later Path to Exile. Really hope to draw like a Tectonic Edge this turn. Another sweet draw would be like a Spreading Seas into a land. I guess Spreading Seas into a Serum Visions that gets us a land, like a Celestial Colonnade. You know, dream big, dream big. Double Temple? Uh-oh. Ew, into Thought Knots here? Alright, well this is particularly brutal. Especially because we have no castable spells now. I'd expect them to still take Wrath here. I mean, I guess they could take Gideon, but I'm at least two turns away from Gideon. I really expect the Supreme Verdict to get out of here. We have some decisions to make if they take the verdict, and then we draw a land for Jace. Alright, well, I still don't want to crack my land just yet. So I want to maximize the potential odds of drawing a land here. Alright, not a great draw either. Uh-oh, this is a smasher. Yeah, we're probably not going to win this one. Basically, at this point, we need to peel. So now I basically have to crack, because I think I have to peel a Supreme Verdict here pretty quickly after drawing a land this coming turn. So my hope here is that I can draw a land, I can Cryptic tap their team, potentially. Alright, pass not the worst. I'm going to pat the Thought Knots here right now, as I want to draw a card. Still leaves me down on the board in two attack steps, but I think I just so badly need to find a land. I think I'll have on a mana source, I can get back into the game reasonably so. I'm not too concerned with accelerating my opponent's mana here. Sure, they could cast an Endbringer, but... I did find the land. Kind of back in it. Obviously could be dead to a Smasher, but that's just one of those things you have to hope doesn't happen. Tide Hollow Sculler. Well, that's not great either. I would expect them to take Cryptic here. I mean, I guess they could take Gideon. I'll be at four. If I draw, say, like Tectonic Edge or a basic, stay at four, play Gideon, kill Reality Smasher. Yeah, the game could get away from them if they don't have another follow-up play here, but they missed a land drop the turn previously, which makes me believe that it's unlikely that they don't have a follow-up here. Smashers come into town. They did take the Cryptic, so I'd assume I'm in a dicey position. Relic's fine. Alright, let's crack this from their Flooded Strand. Or sorry, Flooded Strand for Hell of Fountain. Guess that turn I actually probably didn't want to crack to maximize. Yeah, I should not have cracked there to maximize the ability to draw a land for Gideon. Alright, well, thankfully we got there anyways. Alright, so let's destroy target tapped creature here. Alright, 4 life, 4 loyalty on Gideon. Opponent's got a 4 mana spell under their Tide Hollow Sculler. Alright, didn't have follow-up play. Putting us to 2. Alright, so we die to a Collective Brutality now, which we know they play at least some number of. Another question is, do we want to try to kill that Tide Hollow Sculler and get our Cryptic back or not? I feel like we do. Plusing the Gideon also has its merits, though. Yeah, I think I'm just going to try to kill a Tide Hollow Sculler. Alright, sweet. I was going to say, I just feel a lot safer if I have this Cryptic in my hand. Alright, so if my opponent plays anything here that's going to kill me, we'll go ahead and Cryptic it, and if they don't, we'll just red for 2. This looks like something that kills us. I would probably call it a Reality Smasher. Alright, counter target spell, draw a card. Ooh, an island. The island is good here. Another Gideon. Alright, so I definitely want to leverage a Selspeth. I think this turn I can actually afford to play safe and just rev before getting Elspeth on the battlefield. So playing here to rev, and then we'll Elspeth clean up the battlefield as we need, as we see fit. It's another Smasher. It's another Smasher. I'm pretty happy with our line of play. It is another Smasher. Alright. That is going to resolve. It's going to go ahead and kill Gideon, so I'm really glad I plussed Gideon now. No, you can't attack their opponent. Gideon asks that you kill him. Alright, so Gideon down. I'm not going to try to rev for two and find a path. I just really want to draw three cards and gain three life here. We can probably summon up another Gideon here, potentially up the Elspeth and just minus to kill a Smasher. Alright, Snapcaster doesn't really have any friendly targets just yet. That being said, I think it's better to have access to that just in case they have the last Smasher. So getting Gideon to kill this Smasher. Leave open Snapcaster. I'm playing this game like hyper passively, but I think when I'm this far ahead and my opponent's bricked so many times, I'm like much more apt to play very, very safe, as I think it's just very difficult to lose the game unless my opponent actually finds one of the Haymaker cards. Alright, so here we'll just go ahead and untap. So let's see, we have access to 8 mana in total. Let's go ahead and plus Gideon on them. And trying to figure out whether or not we can just slam Elspeth on the table here, if we should play Jace to protect Gideon. I don't really think we need to protect Gideon here, but maybe I'm wrong. Yeah, let's just play super safe again. We'll just play Jace and start plussing Jace, so Gideon's gonna force all these little tokens to attack this turn. Jace is going to make it so they all don't deal any damage. We're getting to the point where we have enough lands now. I'm going to be able to Snapcaster Sphinx's Rev soon. Oh man, I thought it was going to be another Smasher. Ghost Quarter, uh-oh. Five mana. Alright, the final Smasher. So it's actually pretty good here that we plus this Gideon and plus this Jace. So the opponent's going to put our Gideon down to two loyalty with their attacks. As again, all the attacks have to go over to Gideon Jura. Slowly but surely, our opponent's trying to get through this attacking here. Now, there's a cool little feature with Magic Online. If you right-click in your combat phase and you're the attacking player, just right-click attack all, and there's actually a drop-down there for who you want to attack. So they can attack me, Jace, or Gideon, but here they don't really have the option. Gideon is not about letting you do what you please. Alright, so all these select tokens and reality smashers get shrunk. Gideon falls back down to two. And, alright, so Spreading Seas, that could just get Ghost Quartered, so we don't want to do that. Let's go ahead and plus Jace. Plus Gideon. Target my opponent. Play the Sun's Champion. And we'll go ahead and minus Elspeth here to finish off this Smasher. Again, no reason to Spreading Seas, really. So our opponent could just Ghost Quarter the land in response. Sure, it'd be a nice thing to just kill their Ghost Quarter, but I think we can do it at a later point in time. Should we ever choose to, that is. Alright, so Super Friends assembled. Oh, alright, well, our opponent didn't want to try to fight through the Super Friends. When four Smashers are already down, it is going to be pretty difficult for them to win. Alright, any changes here for Game 3? Oh, wait a minute, that was game one. Goodness gracious. I had totally forgotten that was game one because I was just so figuring that we had lost and we got Thought Knots here to Mr. Landrop, but I didn't even realize that was game one. All right, that was awesome. Totally could not have told you that was game one. I guess I could have looked at my opponent's exile pile and certainly figured it out. All right, well, now that we've won game one, negate, spell snare, mana leaks, you can all get out of here. Blessed Alliance. Let's see, what else do we want here? Might have to use mana leaks anyway. Not have enough against black white Eldrazi. Mana leaks are at least playable magic cards in this matchup. Spellstare, they don't really have, like, Chalice of the Void for one. And even then, Chalice of the Void for one wouldn't be too horrible. But it's not something I expect to see from our opponent when they're on the Tidal Skeller Collective Brutality version. For that reason, we could leave in Spellsnare, but it's just so ineffective otherwise. I'd almost rather have a Vendilion Click, but Vendilion Click trades really poorly. Rest in Peace is certainly bad, as we're more likely to use the graveyard than our opponent. Stony Silence tops Relic. I just don't want to be boarding in a card trying to hose my opponent's cards that cycle. Especially when it's not a card they're going to board out realistically, but it is a card they could in theory if they had just a ton of sideboard options. Alright, I'll leave the Spell Snare in, as embarrassing as it could possibly be. Alright. Let's crush this game two here. An island and a bunch of nonsense. I like nonsense, but too much of it. This hand of the Arian is quite solid. We'll keep this. Definitely keep Serum Visions. Alright, see what we can do from here. Uh-oh, shocking themselves. We're probably getting Inquisitioned or Thought Seized. Uh-oh, later Supreme Verdict. It's nice knowing ya. Also, now that we know our opponent is Lingering Souls, this chase is a lot better than it could have been. Alright, let's see our visions. It up here, see what action we can find. Path to Exile. The Tectonic Edge is decent in multiples. We do rather particularly, however, need to find a Supreme Verdict to leverage it, though. I think I'm just going to put it on the bottom. I'll keep this Flooded Strand and likely crack this Flooded Strand next turn. Go ahead and search for Hallow Fountain. We have double white and double blue. Thought Seized again. That's not cool. Wow, immediately took Blessed Alliance. So they certainly have a Smasher in their hand. Based on taking the Attacker Edict, I call these Attacker Edicts. I don't really know what the second Attacker first iteration was. Somebody in the comments might be able to fill me in, but Wasteland Strangler with no targets. Deal. You can play a 3-mana 3-2. But yeah, once they take that, I just usually assume they have Reality Smasher over something like a Thought Knot Seer or something of that nature. Alright, what do I want to draw this turn? How about a Spreading Seas? How about a Flooded Strand? Certainly accept Flooded Strand. Again, I'm just going to fetch here also. Thin at the deck. I'm going to fetch at some point during this game. So may as well just get the other Flooded Strand, as we won't need our Scalding Tarns ever go find more white. Alright, there's the temple. Probably just pitching the planes here to kill us. Yeah, let's pitch planes. And we'll crack this. So we're gonna fall to 15 here. And be in a not fantastic position, but also not a horrible one either. We're definitely at the point where if we just draw a land and a Gideon, we could easily spiral the game out of control in our favor. I think I'm pretty likely to just play Jace next turn in minus, even though I know it's going to die to Mutavault or String. Oops. I think our opponent clicked there through attackers. That was lucky for us. Get some extra points of life. Alright, give Nidra Snapcaster Mage. Does that change anything for us? I think it does, actually. I think we could Snapcaster potentially to block the Wasteland Strangler, make them sack a Smasher if they have it, so... I'm actually going to try to hold this Jace, as I would like it if we could fight through Lingering Souls effectively. Uh-oh, more Mutavaults. Alright, animating the Mutavault. And the wrong one at that. Alright, awkward. Do not believe my opponent has used the Magic Online interface. Alright, so here I'm just going to Snapcaster and Blessed Alliance them. And then I'll block whatever's the remaining creature. Let's get Blessed Alliance. Target opponent sacks an attacking creature. Alright, some lands down. If we find a big draw here, a Mana Leak. Mana Leak's not terrible. It would allow us to kill a Mutavault here at the tech edge, but then we're down to three lands and we still can't cast this Jace. I think it's important enough that I'll... want to get Jace down, but if my opponent draws a Smasher, obviously it's going to look so foolish. And I don't really want to minus my Jace and just say, okay, I'll trade it for, you know, a mini factor fiction here. Alright, I think I'm just going to pass. Hopefully get to leverage this Mana Leak against a powerful threat. Think if my opponent attacks me with a Mutavault, I'll just take it this time, but potentially blow it up on instep. A Relic of Progenitus. That is fine. Later graveyards. Inquisition, huh? Well... guess we may as well Mana Leak this, see if our opponent will pay and not have written down our hand of Jace. Shucks, they know. Alright, firing up the Mutavault again. I really want to kill this thing. Alright, I'm going to do it and I'm going to try to draw land here. I think this is the more ambitious play. But I think it's certainly the one with highest upside. Upside, unfortunately, definitely not achieved. Even more so punished, because now if my opponent draws a Thought Not Seer or something, and I'm just left with a Snapcaster Mage, it's pretty bad for us. Uh-oh. Ugh, Lingering Souls? Alright, well, I am very happy that I protected my Jace then, because now I just need to get Jace down and start plussing it. I was going to say, I wouldn't even accept a Colonnade this turn. Would not be unhappy if I had to draw a Colonnade there to get my land into play. So I shouldn't have six here in case our opponent... Whoa, Athalia? Not cool, man. I honestly did not think they were white-black hate bears, but maybe they boarded into this? I mean, the Tidehall Scholar is pretty usual, but... Alright, well now we need another land to deal with Athalia also for the Jace. Alright, there we go. So, have the board somewhat under control now. As the Thalia is basically trading hits with our Jace. Best draw I think we could find would be a Supreme Verdict. We do have Snapcaster Mana Leak online next turn if our opponent doesn't play something super sweet this turn. Uh-oh. They find a Thought Knot Seer for our Snapcaster here. Alright, not great. Probably gonna have to minus Jace now to try to find a Supreme Verdict. I think we're only down one copy that got Thought Seized earlier. Could also find like a Cryptic. Gideon doesn't work just yet. Spreading Seas. Well, you're not gonna do it just yet, friend. So we're gonna have to minus Jace here. There's a Supreme Verdict. We will definitely take that. We'll take the Supreme Verdict pile in the dark. My opponent wants to get frustrated and concede and give me all three, I would certainly take it also. Alright, let's choose pile number two. Put path and then turn on the bottom. Let's blow up all of our opponent's sweet creatures. And get a card from the Thought Knots here. Hopefully it's a colonnade. Ooh, another one, good one though. Certainly be happy with that. Alright, so Spreading Seas here, I'm really eyeing this Eldrazi Temples. It's my opponent's only colorless source. Oh, well, now I'm eyeing that Shambling Vent. So this might be a closer decision. Let's start off with Serum Vision here, as I'm almost certainly going to plus Jace. Oh, a Tectonic Edge and a Gideon? Goodness gracious, those are good cards. So what I kind of want to do now... So I can Serum Visions into that Tech Edge. I could Tech Edge and Spreading Seas. Yeah, let's do that. So let's keep Gideon on top and Tech Edge on top. Let's... use the Spreading Seas on the Temple. Draw that, play this. Now we play the Serum Vision so that we get the most scry value. Supreme Verdict and a Plane, so we definitely don't need the Planes. I'll take having an extra Supreme Verdict, no harm in having extra copies of those. Plus Jace here. It should just be a routine finish to the ball game. Alright, sweet deal. Managed to take down the match, and let's go ahead and chat about the deck, shall we? Alright, everybody. Let's chat a little bit here about some blue-white control. Ended up going 3-2 in this set. Ended up probably about average overall in terms of the matchups. I think we had overall good matchups, so kind of disappointed with the 3-2 finish, but... I mean, as far as, you know, records go, I would guess that and 2-3 are the most likely outcomes, seeing as they're both close to 50%, so all in all, not too concerned. Deck is somewhat clunky, we definitely ran into that a couple times. It's possible you may want to cut some number of the cheap sort of interactive cards in the early game for, like, Talisman of Progress, I believe is the name of the blue-white talisman. If you're into playing as many fours and thighs as we have here, overall, though, I think the only thing that I was really unhappy with was the Dismember. I think that white has access to good enough removal that we probably don't need this in the list. I think if I were going to play this over, I'd either have the second Blessed Alliance from the sideboard and extra add an extra sideboard card, or play an extra land, or an extra counterspell, or something of that nature. Like, the Dismember was, I mean, certainly fine, but the four life certainly added up, as this is different from the previous version where I played where I had Wall of Omens. And speaking of Wall of Omens, I was checking out some lists earlier on and had some people message me on Twitter that they were talking about a Wall of Omens version with Gideon, the new 3-mana Gideon from Amonkhet, Gideon of the Trials, I believe is its name, where kind of just play the wall, get them to overextend, play Gideon, also use Gideon to sort of like lock out a creature with his +2 ability, or +1 ability? Whichever, however many loyalty the 3-mana Gideon gains, where you plus on a creature and then it can't deal combat damage. Get your opponent to extend down to the board and then Supreme Verdict them, and then just leverage the power of the Gideon also against certain combo matchups, as his emblem will prevent you from dying. Let's go ahead and pull that Gideon up here so people can see what we're talking about. Hopefully I have one in this account. I may have moved them to a different account for testing already. It looks like I did. Alright, let's go ahead and grab that out, so if you haven't played Gideon of the Trials yet, you'll know what we're talking about. Alright, here we go. So yeah, you can +1, prevent all combat, or prevent all damage to be dealt by target permanent. And then looking at the emblem, as long as you control Gideon Planeswalker, you can't lose the game, your opponents can't win the game. No, that says a Gideon Planeswalker, so it also works later in the game when you have Gideon Jura, where you can just keep plusing Gideon to abnormal large amounts of loyalty, so that it doesn't become a creature and can't get hit by things like Terminate and Path to Exile, as this is one of the Gideons that doesn't have the Indestructible Clause. Yeah. First Gideon, sometimes you get some things wrong. But this is a really great mid-range threat. Helps you, actually, if you look at this problem here, where it exiles 1s and 2s, and then sweet 4, 5s, and 6s. So I think Gideon of Trials might be a sweet way to take this deck. It's something that if I go ahead and record with this sometime in the future, I will definitely give a shot to. And would definitely report back on. Otherwise, I think Blue White's a fine deck. I think it's a deck that I enjoy playing just because you have all these sweet Planeswalkers. Obviously, getting to play with four Wrath of Gods that are uncounterable and four Cryptic Commands is also sweet. I think at the end of the day, though, it is something that's good against the top two decks, but it kind of struggles against the sort of combo decks. It struggles against the value creature decks, as it doesn't have just this way to prevent your opponents from actually playing. It doesn't apply a quick clock. By not applying a quick clock and then not preventing your opponent from playing spells, like, it's not going Cryptic Snap Cryptic into Kolaghan's Command like Grixis is. It's not Stubborn Annulling their spells. It's not getting them dead like, say, Affinity or Burn will, because you are trying to kill your opponent with, you know, Gideon Jura attacks, Elspeth getting to an emblem. A lot of our opponents, in the case it was, oh, I'm bored of this, I'm going to concede because I don't want to sit through this misery for another 12 turns. Like, your opponents can win these games. I mean, you can certainly draw just 12 lanes in a row. Even when you just have, you know, your one sweet Planeswalker out. It happens. It's not likely, but it can certainly happen. So, applying a slow clock in Modern, probably not the best place to be. I do think that the Gideon idea is something that could help correct that, and something that I would try in the future. But other than that, thanks for watching, and I will see you next week with some Standard videos. Thanks for watching, everybody. Have a good one.